I guess it's in the camera. At times, our own light goes out and it is rekindled from a spark from another person. Each of us has cause to think with deep gratitude of those who have lighted the flame within us. Albert Schweitzer. Now we'll be singing hymn 38. We have good news of near biblical proportions. The board has decided that we will gather our courage and our masks and meet in person on Sunday, October 26th. Reverend Ruth will deliver the message that day. We will sit with chairs distanced and everyone masked, except the speakers when speaking. The plan is to open the windows and doors to promote air circulation as well. Following the service, we will have a picnic finger foods potluck outdoors. We also plan to broadcast on Zoom for folks who still prefer to watch us virtually. We are so excited at the thought of finally meeting our congregation en masse in person. What a blessing. Also, Reverend Ruth will be here locally from the 20th through the 26th. Please contact the church or Reverend Ruth personally if you wish to visit with her. And please continue to remember that our donations to the fellowship are important to the continued success of our mission and vision. The church operates on the goodwill of our congregation. Give as you are willing and able. And now, let us come into a time of prayer. Prayer invites God to be present in our spirits and in our lives. Prayer cannot bring water to parched land, nor mend a broken bridge, nor rebuild a ruined city. But prayer can water an arid soul, mend a broken heart, and rebuild a weakened will. Next part of our service is joys and concerns. In our efforts to continue as a caring community, we are updating our pastoral care team ministry here at the Fellowship and seeking volunteers to help with basic support services, such as bringing meals, picking up groceries and medicines, and respite for the primary caregiver. Our first care recipients will be our dear friends, Susie and Ken Sizemore. Anyone interested in helping as much or as little as you are able, please contact Reverend Ruth. She has an email, UUREVRUTH@gmail.com, or the phone number, can I say it? Is 205-218-1666. And now we're going to reflect on our joys and concerns by listening to or singing along with the hymn Spirit of Life, played by Ron and sung by Matt. Next, we have Serena Dee Latiolais is our speaker today. Many of us are familiar with her. We just celebrated our 5th anniversary, and it's a joy for us to listen and learn from Serena Dee Latiolais.
Good morning. There are 365 days in a year. If you are a normal Unitarian Universalist, is there really even such a thing? Well, you probably attend church pretty frequently on Sundays. If you go every Sunday, that's 52 times a year. 52 times a year that you bring some sort of spiritual ceremony into your life. If you are a UU pagan like I am, you can probably add some days to that. Even if you celebrate all 8 Sabbaths, those are high holy days, and all 13 esbats, those are full moons, well, you're still left with 344 days that are not holy days. What about all the normal days that remain? Do you stop being a Unitarian Universalist or a UU Pagan just because it isn't a holy day or a Sunday? I don't think so. Being a UUer or a UU Pagan isn't something you take on and off with your Sunday go-to-church clothes or your pagan robes. Once you start to follow this path, it becomes a part of you. It becomes part of your viewpoint into the world around you. I know for me, when I started to seriously follow my spiritual lifestyle, I started seeing things all around me. Sometimes I would see a Nordic rune or a pagan symbol in the most obscure places, like the corner convenience store. Sometimes I would see evidence of social justice, hope, and help from my fellow humans, even those who were not Unitarian Universalist. One purpose of ritual or ceremony is to bring us closer to the divine. Now, many religions and philosophies recommend daily prayer and meditation. There's no real reason why we cannot appreciate and borrow the good ideas from other spiritual paths and even make them our own. Indeed, we do just that. That is part of being a good Unitarian Universalist. The idea of regular prayer and meditations are excellent places to start increasing your daily connection to a goddess and or God or to your higher self. After all, one of the main ideas of having a spiritual life is to deepen that connection and understanding between you and a higher power. I think the best place to start is in the beginning. And by beginning, I mean the start of the day. I used to begin my days every morning with a prayer to deity. I asked for her care and protection throughout the day. I also ask that she help me to be the best me I can be for the day. These days, I do not start my day by asking, but before I even leave the bed, I say this: thank you for letting me wake at dawn with a winged heart. I give thanks for another day of loving. For years, I thought that quote came from the Bible. But in my 20s, I was introduced to the Lebanese poet and writer, Khalil Gibran. That's where the quote comes. Later in the morning with my coffee, I attempt a more focused type of morning prayers. These prayers are always spiked with gratefulness. Sometimes I add to my morning prayer if I have something on my mind. I'll ask for guidance to help solve a problem that I've been struggling with. Or if I have a different activity, like a doctor's appointment or a presentation to give, I'll ask God or Goddess or my higher self to give me the strength and or clarity needed for that. I thank her and then get ready to start the day. Later in the morning, I try to find time for meditation, because prayer and meditation are not the same thing. More on that in a bit. Another way to reach out to deity is with gratitude. When was the last time you gave a prayer of thanks? Think how lucky you are to have regular meals a day, to have running water, to have a roof over your head. And the list goes on and on. What a perfect opportunity to connect with divinity or your higher self. You can make a blessing over each meal. It doesn't need to be anything elaborate. It doesn't even need to be out loud. In less than the time it took to prepare the meal, you can connect with your understanding of God on a regular basis during the day. It can be as simple as saying, "Thank you for feeding me today and bless me and the food I'm about to eat." At my house, We try to remember to bless the food with each meal. But I also bless the food that I, as I'm about to prepare it, because it has been my experience that most people, when saying the so-called blessing, are actually giving prayers of gratitude to deity. Nothing wrong with that. It's just not the same as a blessing. The act of giving back can also strengthen your connection to deity. There are many ways of giving back. If you have a yard, you can create a compost pile. My friend's daughter, I had a friend who had a daughter growing up, who loved to do her special chore of feeding Mother Nature, as she called it. Every evening, she took the vegetable trimmings and the table scrapings, and she would take them out to the compost pile. She enjoyed her evening conversations with deity. Other ways of giving back include putting out bird seed and recycling. Giving of yourself to the community is another. These actions can include donating time or material possessions to local charities, participating in blood drives, or becoming active in community organizations that promote a cause you care about. The list of options is as endless as your imagination and as your health and time and resources will allow. What makes these things spiritual, in my opinion, is how you approach them. Make them special by adding a sense of ceremony to them. Bless them the same way you would bless food before partaking. I try to find some time most afternoons to remember to say prayers of healing for other people, specifically for those who have asked for it. My faith worldview allows me to send long-distance healing energies and or prayers for the best outcome for those people. Even those who are terminal oftentimes need prayers and energy, if for no other reason than for a peaceful transition to the other side. At the end of the day, an additional opportunity presents itself in the form of bedtime prayers. Gone are the prayers said by kneeling by the side of the bed. No more kneeling for this girl. But thanks is given for seeing us safely through another day. I use this time before sleep to review my day's activities. Laying there in bed, between the application of a CPAP machine and before I nod off, I make a mental note of what behaviors and actions that I've been proud of today, and also where I'd like to improve on how I interact with others. After some time, many, many, many months of doing this, I can only hope that I'm becoming better at the things that I can be proud of. There are fewer days when I feel like I have caused injury to others with my words or actions. Many spiritual seekers keep a daily journal with their private thoughts and ideas. They use it as a kind of mini ceremony each day. Personally, I have never been able to do this for the long term. I cannot tell you how many journals I have started, only to be side-railed after a few days or weeks. But hey, I keep trying. I have developed my daily behaviors over years of trial and error. Some actions have been added and some taken away over that time. In the long run, the result is that thoughts of deity are never far from my heart and mind. I am a Unitarian Universalist pagan all day, every day. I don't need to wait until next Sunday or Holy Day or full moon to experience the joy that being a child of God brings to me. It is part of my ongoing practice. A large part of my practice has been in creating a sacred space, sometimes more than one. Sacred space can be as small as the breath taken in during prayer, as large as a cathedral, or as expansive as an ocean view. Unless you already have a special, peaceful place set up in your home, I suggest you challenge yourself to create a sacred space somewhere within your living area. Perhaps you are fortunate enough to have an extra room you can use to retreat to when you need some time to yourself. My niece has a room she calls Middle Earth. When it is time for a child to leave the nest, consider converting the newly evacuated bedroom into a sacred space rather than making it a guest room that's only used occasionally. Do not feel as if you must wait until you have a spare room to create this sacred space. Consider opening up any corner. And if it is in your faith worldview, consider building an altar there. Or empty a closet of its clutter and toss a couple of pillows on the floor to use in quiet prayer or meditation. Once you have chosen this space, clear the entire room where your sacred space will exist, even if only a corner is being used. A fresh coat of paint on the walls might be nice. Incorporate household rules as to who is and who is not allowed into this space, two-legged and four-legged. Is this to be your space alone, or can family members use it when you're not using it? Select pleasing visuals, kinesthetics, sounds, and smells for your sacred space surroundings. I like to fill my sacred space with personal items with which I have been gifted from loving friends and family members. Over the years, I've been gifted with lots and lots of things. I'm sure many of us my age have. Objects and pictures my now grown-up children have made or given me over the years. Something from one of my ancestors is in the corner. A river clamshell given to me from a friend who used to live along the Mississippi is filled with acorns to honor the deer spirit of my ancestors. A small metal sculpture of a deer to honor the family totem. Smaller items have found their ways into a bowl kept just for such treasures. A handful of seashells, a dime for promised prosperity. I found this dime shining up at me from the grasses under my feet at a roadside park where I stopped to meditate one day. A chunk of quartz for clarity, a crystal ball for my dear departed sister Irene, and more goodies. Once your space is in place, you will likely want to honor it by doing some type of ceremony, be it pagan or Native American or Christian or Unitarian, or just giving a prayer of gratitude or blessing it in whatever way best aligns with your belief system. You will soon find yourself drawn to this sacred space more and more as you seek solace and restfulness that it might provide you. You begin to wonder how you ever lived without this sacred space that offers much healing, comfort, and warmth. Clear your space regularly and frequently import new favorite things into your space. Remove clutter from the area with some old-fashioned mundane dusting and vacuuming. Many people like to smudge the area with sage, but there are other methods, such as the use of rosemary branches dipped in spring water for clearing energies. Also, other types of incense, such as cone or stick, or just clapping or bell ringing. Open the windows and let some fresh air breeze in. When setting up or changing out your sacred space, don't forget artwork, flowers, scarves, feathers, crystals, gemstones, seashells, chimes, fountains, drums, candles, incense, photographs, teddy bear, books, mirrors, pillows, a sofa or favorite chair, grandma's quilt, a journal, colored ink pens, etc. You get the picture. Some people don't like to create sacred space in their homes, but instead choose a spot outside, maybe a garden area or a hiking trail, or just some part of nature where they can go and recharge their spiritual batteries, as it were. I have a friend who over the years liked to actually garden. And I do believe that her garden, getting down in the dirt, was her sacred space. Whatever your venue, creating sacred space is important to your spiritual well-being. And what does one do in that sacred space? Prayer, meditation, contemplation, reading a good book, try to avoid computers, just sitting. The Japanese call it zazen. There's a Buddhist joke that says one should meditate 20 minutes a day unless you are busy, and then you should meditate 40 minutes a day. what is meditation? Well, that could be a whole presentation in itself. But in my opinion, in a nutshell, meditation is the opposite of prayer. I, along with many others, believe that prayer is talking to deity and meditation is listening. I do not put a time limit on my prayers because I'm the one talking, but it has been a hard and arduous journey for me to learn meditation, the art of listening to the still, small voice within, to my inner guidance system. Too often I have listened to the advice, good or bad, of others, but not to my own advice. In meditation, I can tune in to who I truly am and lean into the spiritual side of myself. I was raised Christian in a Catholic faith. Unlike many Unitarian Universalists and pagans, I do not have horror stories to tell about that time. I enjoyed my Catholic experiences, but as I matured, I found them limiting. One of the major limiting things was the way I was taught to pray. My prayers were more of a plea bargaining, a negotiating, instead of praise, worship, or today, mostly partnership. Today, my prayers are, as I said earlier, reaching for the gratitude. Because gratitude is an outgrowth of the love we have for our understanding of deity. And love is really all there is. Many people think that the opposite of love is hate, but it has been my experience that the opposite of love is fear. It is difficult to feel the love when one harbors fears. Fear truly is, like in the Dune series, the mind killer, but it is also a soul killer. Reaching for those feelings of gratitude help us to realign ourselves back into a position of love, of hope for the future. There's a song by Elaine Silver that says, love is all there is, and I believe it. I believe it to be the bedrock, the foundation of any spirituality in our lives. So let us go forth with love in our hearts and gratitude on our tongues. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to serve you. Blessed be and amen. And I will turn it over to my beloved Jerry.
Thank you so much, Serena. Reflections are, there's so many reflections that y'all are going to have your own time to reflect. It's interesting that a Christian married a pagan and found the love that exists where there's love, when you just have love. I think of my spiritual journey and my spirit guides that are people that have passed on, that are what I call like a place like heaven, where I still have those people that still are in my life. Like Grandma Johnson, Jesus Christ, Buddha, that I have connections, that I know the love and I feel the love and the gratitude of having that love. It's such a good place to be. So now let's have a song with Ron, page 34.
Sunday.
our closing words before extinguishing the chalice. For all who see God, may God go with you. For all who embrace life, may life return your affection. For all who seek a right path, may a way be found, and the courage to take it step by step. May the Eternal bless you and protect you. May the Eternal smile on you and favor you. May the Eternal befriend you and prosper you. We'll close with Go Lift It Up.
Looks like we can unmute.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey.
Hey, Cheryl.
And you're